I want to speak today about a matter that more recently is of great interest and is related to the issue of Bible and possibly anti-Semitic accusations. And this is due to the fact that, for example, in America, they have come at the beginning of May with a new law called the Anti-Semitism Awareness Act of 2023. And among the claims of this law is one that says using the symbols and images associated with classic anti-Semitism, e.g., claims of Jews killing Jesus or blood libel, to characterize Israel or Israelis. So there's many other here, but that's the main point. And we can see indeed that there were quite a number, I think 91 members of the House of Representatives who voted against it. And here we have quotations of two representatives, Marjorie Taylor Greene, a Republican from Georgia, who says, I will not be voting for the Anti-Semitism Awareness Act today that would convict Christians of anti-Semitism for believing the gospel that says Jesus was handed over to Herod to be crucified by the Jews. And there's another representative, Matt Gaetz, Republican from Florida, who says the gospel itself would meet the definition of anti-Semitism under the terms of this bill. The bill says the definition of anti-Semitism includes contemporary examples of anti-Semitism identified by the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance, and one of these examples includes claims of Jews killing Jesus. And he says the Bible is clear, there is no myth or controversy, and this, therefore, I will not support this bill. And here I'll go to the fact checkers, but this truly, some truth can transpire in this fact-checking stuff too. It's undeniable. So they say here the Anti-Defamation League considers blaming Jews for killing Jesus a myth and said it has been used to justify violence against Jews for centuries. Historians as well as Christian leaders have agreed that the claim is baseless. After centuries of teaching that Jewish people as a whole killed Jesus, the Catholic Church rejected the belief in 1965, a stance then Pope Benedict XVI reiterated in 2011. Now, of course, my comment here will be based on the new revelation, which is the word of the Lord through Jacob Lorber and Gottfried Mayrhofer, given in the 19th century through inner word, same as all the other messages, prophecies received by the old prophets gathered in the Bible, and including John the Apostle, the Revelation. So, yeah, what we have in the New Revelation, I say this every time, is the same Jesus, the same gospel, an extraordinary confirmation of the scriptures that is practically unveiling all the other mysteries of the scriptures and of the spiritual creation, natural creation, God and the human destiny. And yeah, the idea is that in the main book of the New Revelation, which is called the Great Gospel of John, 25 books of 100 pages, it's about 7,000 pages in total, we find everything that is in the Gospels, plus countless other things that happened during the Lord's 3 years of ministry, presented by the Lord himself. And so in the last book, book 25, we find also the end of this ministry, you know, the condemnation of the Lord, the passion and the crucifixion and the resurrection testimony. And I think it's very important to see what, according to my firm belief, what the Lord himself is saying on this matter, because truly, even from a common sense perspective, it's obvious that the whole Jewish people was not condemning people, was not executing people, was not agreeing with this. I would emphasize how extremely blind and stupid it is to condemn a whole people or even a whole group of people for the actions of a few. Especially in cases where there is an obvious opposition to these actions, you know. So all the atrocities of history are based on this condemnation of entire groups and nations because of the sins of the few. And once, you know, the machine of the state is in place, of the government, where the authorities judge even the people of that group or nation for not adhering to the official position as enemies and traitors of the country, then of course there's no way but to follow the leaders and to be entangled in this vicious circle of violence and fratricide killings. And when I speak about fratricide, to me, fratricide is any killing in the world. We're all brothers and sisters from a spiritual perspective, because we are all children of the same God. Even though some of us may have different opinions about this God or even reject the idea of a God, we still are children of God, and our spirits, though totally asleep, are a testimony of this, and the law of love and wisdom from God is written in each heart and mind. So even the basic tenets of love for fellow men is something that each human in their conscience and heart can recognize as correct and true. Because of this, it is embedded in all of us, because yes, indeed, we are all brothers and sisters. So, right, coming back to the issue, I will show you, we have a link to the books of the New Revelation on Internet Archive. So if you press this link, you will go right here. And the books are all in PDF format, ready to be downloaded on this side. And if you download here book 25, you're gonna see this final book of the Gospel of John right here. And we're gonna go towards the end, chapter 97, where we can read about the hearing and the condemnation of Jesus, and the said, this is the word of the Lord given through inner word. So it's the Lord himself who is speaking here, or he's given the other interventions of people or disciples around him. But what you have in this translation in English with red is exactly what the Lord is saying, either narrating something or speaking at the time of his mission, thus 2000 years ago. So the Lord says, so this is after his arrest in the Garden of Gethsemane. The march walked now through over the Kidron, through the same gate through which my entrance took place. The temple guards brought me first to Hannas, who was the brother-in-law of the high priest Caiaphas. Hannas was the first to whom I was taken, because he was the representative of Caiaphas and had always been very active in this matter, and therefore the news was brought to him first that it succeeded to capture me. Nota bene. It is absolutely not the intention to repeat here everything that is already stated in detail in the Gospel of John, because this writing must not make the Gospel of John unnecessary. However, the following historic events will only fill in the gaps of what seems to be lacking. The manner in which Hannas received me, and also the fall of Peter, can be read there. Hannas sent me bound to Caiaphas. Judas, who realized now that everything seemed to happen differently than he had expected, saw how I was led away, and being perplexed and full of fear for the success of his intention, he followed the march. He also wanted to walk through with me to the high priest, but the entrance was denied to him. So we have to put here in parentheses what the issue is with Judas, who really wanted not to have the Lord killed, but on the contrary, to have the Lord display all his spiritual powers so he could be appointed king of the Jews in Jerusalem in front of all the Pharisees, and of course himself as a co-author of this great victory to be eventually recognized as the right hand of the Lord. So yeah, it was a very bad mixture of politics with his own spiritual knowledge of the Lord, which led to nothing. It always leads to nothing, because you cannot serve two masters. But going back, so at Caiaphas' place, the whole high council was gathered, and they were already waiting for a long time for my appearance, looking for revenge. Now accusations were formally brought against me, and witnesses arose against me who had to testify that I committed high treason, and especially the entrance into Jerusalem was used against me, and also that I had dared to walk on the holy place, by which I attributed priestly power to myself, which I did not possess. After that, it was accurately proven that I wanted to stir up the people against the Roman emperor in order to make myself king. But when it came to it, to find witnesses for this who could under oath confirm my intent by my words, they did not find anyone. Finally, the witnesses came forward who stated that I had said, "Break this temple down, and I will rebuild it in 3 days." Caiaphas said now that this was an insult against the temple itself, for in order to accomplish this, divine authority was needed, which can only possess the anointed of the Lord, who will once come in great power. But I had said that I was the Christ, the anointed one, and therefore he adjured me to say whether I really was Christ, the Son of God. On this I answered, "You have said it. But I say to you all, from now on, it will happen that the Son of Man will sit at the right side of the power and will go in the clouds of heaven to the Father who lives in him." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has blasphemed God. What other witnesses do we need? You have heard his blasphemies." Of course, the others agreed immediately, for in the council only those were gathered whom Caiaphas knew that they were dedicated to him and compliant. But those who were in one way or another friendly disposed towards me, which became already apparent during the last meetings, the purpose was to capture me and to keep the betrayal of Judas hidden. Therefore, the death sentence was soon ready, and it was only a matter of receiving the approval of Pontius Pilate. Very early in the morning, I was taken there and the case was presented to the governor. I was a rebel and a blasphemer, and as such, I was guilty to be put to death. Pontius Pilate, who knew everything about my entry and could not find any rebellious act in it, tried to save me because he, as a Roman, was inclined to see in me some kind of demigod with exceptional powers. Now he spoke to me as one can read in the Gospel of John, and he said to the temple servants who were standing before the courthouse that he did not find me guilty. Then one of the high priests came forward, and he explained to him once more that I had traveled through the country preaching against the temple and its servants, who surely were the highest authority in the country and representatives of God. On this occasion, it was said that I was from Galilee. Pilate was glad to hear this statement because he saw an escape to put the whole matter off his back. Galilee stood under the supreme authority of Herod, and therefore he was the one who could make a judgment in this. So he quickly closed the hearing and ordered to send me to Herod to speak out justice on one of his citizens. Herod was very pleased when I was brought to him, because now his wish to personally see me was fulfilled, and now he wanted to convince himself as to what was true of the many rumors about my miraculous power. He had me immediately brought before him and ordered those around him to leave. We stayed alone. He expressed his amazement that a man as I, who possessed exceptional powers, had let himself be captured, and he wanted to know how this could have happened. But I did not give him an answer, so that he became embarrassed and he explicitly wanted an answer from me. Since I remained silent, he became more and more irritated and became enraged about this, so that he rushed to me and threatened to torture me. I only calmly looked at him, and immediately the old sinner trembled so much in his heart by that glance that he fearfully called out to his men. I became extremely terrifying to him, and to hide his fear, he mocked me now in the presence of his servants of the court, who obviously supported at once the mockery words of their ruler. Herod said now that he was misled in the hope to achieve something by supernatural power, and now he wanted at least to take as much as possible advantage of the whole situation. Therefore, he commanded to take me back to Pilate, while he indicated in polite words that he gladly wanted to be submissive to the sovereignty of Rome, and renounced his right to judge one of his citizens who, according to the statement of the temple, also tried to resist the sovereignty of Rome. With the white robe that Herod ordered to give to me as a sign of submission, I returned to Pilate again, who was not exactly pleased about my return, but rather about Herod's way of acting, which later on achieved also a complete reconciliation between the two rulers. Meanwhile, Pilate has been warned by his wife, who saw in a dream how the good and the bad ones were separated by the sun, and he tried to set me free. Therefore, he came upon the idea to suggest to the people to release me, since it was the custom at the time of Passover to free a criminal whom the people could choose. However, the priests and temple servants incited all their adherers who were standing in front of the courthouse, and they did not allow anyone of the other people to be with them, so that the intimidated crowd who adhered to me were not standing close by, but rather the clan of the temple who tried with all might to reach their goal, namely, to get rid of me. Since Barabbas had a good reputation with the temple, as already mentioned before, on the question of the governor which prisoner he had to release, they immediately shouted, "Barabbas," this according to what they had agreed, and they demanded that I should be crucified, by which it was always emphasized that I was a rebel and was against the emperor. Pilate did not know what to do anymore, because even if enough accusations were brought against me, he personally could not agree with them. Now, he thought that only a flogging could impose a sufficient punishment upon me, and so he gave command to it. Consequently, I was flogged. After this punishment, the helpers brought me out in a very miserable condition, in a purple cloak and crowned with a crown of thorns, because Pilate hoped that this sight would bring the Jews to have pity so that he could set me free. But the heart of the Jews was harder than stone, and again they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate repeated that he found no guilt in me that was worthy of death, and that I had been punished enough. Then those who stood in front and most embittered Pharisaic priests shouted, "He has to die, for he has blasphemed God. He claimed to be God's son, and according to our law, the one who blasphemes God must die." When he heard that, Pilate was frightened even more, because his Roman idea that I could be a demigod received now new nourishment. Therefore, he entered the house again, and the helpers brought me back in again. And he asked me where I came from, that means my ancestry, and from which country I was, because he wanted to believe me, not my accusers. But I did not answer him, and this out of exhaustion. Pilate asked again, as it is written in John chapter 9, verse 10. Also the further events happened according to verses 11, 12, and 13. Now, Pilate, who was frightened because he knew the temple and knew that they would do anything when they wanted to persist, wanted to make an end to the case and sat down on the judgment seat, a ceremonial custom with the Romans when an indisputable sentence had to be spoken out. He presented me again to the people and asked them whom he had to release. The adherers shouted again, "Barabbas." Now someone was sent to him to give him his freedom. Then Pilate pointed at me and said, "See, here is your king. What must happen to him?" Again, the gang shouted, "Crucify him." Pilate said mockingly, "Must I crucify your king?" Now one of the high priests came forward and said very emphatically, "We have no other king except for the emperor, but this one here is against the emperor and has made himself king. The guilt is on him." Pilate said very seriously, "And what if nevertheless innocent blood will be spilled?" "Then his blood will come over us and our children," shouted the high priest loudly. And the adherers loudly exclaimed their agreement on this and repeated it many times. Then Pilate saw that he could not help me without bringing himself into serious trouble. He also feared that the Roman reputation could suffer by it if he would show too much weakness. As an outer sign that he felt free of the responsibility, he washed his hands in the presence of all the people and said, "Pilate, I am innocent of the blood of this righteous person, for according to our law, he has done nothing wrong. It can be different according to your law, as you say, and therefore I hand him now over to your law." Then he handed me over to the temple guards, who were ready, and they took me immediately into custody. This at the same time when Barabbas was set free and loudly hailed by the people. So then comes the chapter about the crucifixion, death, and burial of Jesus, and I have read this also. But the most important thing that we can see here is that not the Jews as a people were guilty and willing to see the Lord on the cross, but in fact the High Council and their main disciples, you know, their main followers, and the people that they have paid in order to support their condemnation in front of Pilate. I think it's very, very important to observe who are the main players in this history of the Lord's condemnation. So first we see that we have indeed the high priest Caiaphas and the other ones of the high council, except Nicodemus. We know that he was a disciple of the Lord, a secret one. And they are the elites of the people at that time, with the exception of the king. They are the religious elites of that time, and also, so to say, the hidden hand that was handling everything in the land. Of course, we had the king also, but the king had practically no real power in this matter, and the king, in fact, didn't want to be a part of this because, though he was the same person who condemned John the Baptist to death, we know that he was tempted. He was a very worldly person and a sinner, but he was tempted by the spiritual truths imparted by these great teachers at the time. So his spiritual eye was not, in fact, completely blind like those of the high Pharisees. So, yeah, so we have the elites and we have their minions and assistants, you know, that support them in reaching their conclusion and in having the condemnation imposed. And then we have, of course, the mercenaries, and the mercenaries belong to the governor, to Pontius Pilate, and they are the executive power. They are not Jews, but they are Romans. And of course, they act as a machine. They just have to do whatever is ordered to them, like all the armies in the world, even today. And you see this mechanism that is put there in place. So, where are the people? Where is the nation in this? The nation is just in their passive complicity with what is unfolding there. And it is a complicity because of the fear and terror that is imposed by the mercenary, the actual powers that can and always suppress the people. So in reality, it wasn't so easy to kill Jesus, and we know from the great Gospel of John and from the Gospels that the High Council has looked for a long time to catch him and to condemn him, but it wasn't possible. But because, as the Lord said, his time was not come yet, he had to accomplish his missionary work first, and then it was his choice to allow this to happen to him according to the will of the Father or the supreme love in God that was in him, in order to, by this, and this is also clearly and largely explained in the New Revelation, to preserve his teaching, you know, that otherwise would have slowly disappeared and been utterly corrupted, and to give his disciples the power to follow this path, this missionary path, even at the price of their life, which really happened after the resurrection and, you know, with the release of God's Holy Spirit on them. And yeah, I just want to tell you that this applies also not only to everything that has historically been committed in matters of crimes, you know, big crimes or wars or persecutions, in which we always have the elites, their main subordinates, their minions, and the mercenaries that are being used for this, but also at the level of each one of us, again, in each human soul, you see these entities, you see the great sins that are corrupting the soul, like, you know, the High Council, the pride. Especially the pride, the envy, the urge for domination. Speaking about envy, envy was the really driving demonic force in all this. as it's written in Matthew chapter 27 here. Even Pontius Pilate knew that for envy they had delivered him. So the main culprits in our own souls are the biggest sins, the pride, the envy, the urge for domination, and the minions, the assistants are all the derived, strategies and plans that we make in order to receive the fulfillment that these big sinners in our hearts are demanding. And the mercenaries are all the acts we are committing that oppose, in fact, the order of unconditional love, mercy, forgiveness, and tolerance that is, in fact, preached by the Lord and is in our spirit of God, in our hearts. And I think it's more than important for this battle against sinful high council to be first won in each one of us for them to be able to oppose the world. So without having this love for fellow men in us, we cannot do, in fact, anything as followers of the Lord. And if we declare ourselves to be Christians, but affirm that the whole people, or even the descendants of the people, have committed a crime, and even the greatest crime as such of crucifying Jesus, our Lord and God, we are still far away in the haze of our own sinful drives. So we cannot do this. We truly need to take each person apart and see what their position is. And even if we discover a great sinner, among us, the Lord knew who were his enemies. Even there, we should pray for their redemption, for their forgiveness, as the Lord has done, even under the highest torture on the cross, and thus to truly love them, to truly love even our enemies. Because as it is written, and I also try to repeat it again and again, through the Spirit of God in them and through the sacrifice of the Lord and the redemption of all matter, the promise of returning to the Lord is in each one of them. And sooner or later, even if it takes eons, it will be accomplished. Satan will have absolutely no dominion among the children of God. None of the human spirits ever created by God will follow him in the end. So that was my intervention today, and I hope I made this point clear, not only from a common sense perspective, but also from a scriptural one. And by scripture, again, I consider the gospel and also the new revelation. So anyway, thank you very much for listening to this. May God bless you and inspire you and give you much love and mercy. Amen.